Okay, good morning everybody. So today we will talk about the circulation. You know that circulation refers to the blood circulation. Inside the cardiovascular system, blood circulates throughout the body. And there are different types of circulations in the human body: systemic circulation, pulmonary circulation, hepatic portal circulation. Those three circulations are present in the adult human body. So those belong to adult circulations. And there is another type of circulation which occurs between the mother and the fetus inside the uterus, and that is called the fetal circulation. So those are different types of circulation present in the human body. Arteries and venous systems. You know that arteries are the blood vessels that take the blood away from the heart, and veins are another types of blood vessels that bring the blood towards the heart. So arteries take the blood away from the heart, make sense? And veins bring the blood towards the heart. We'll talk about the arteries and veins in the body. We'll identify the major arteries and veins in the body. We'll see where they are located and how they branch. Then we'll talk about a arterial structure present in the bottom of the brain, at the base of the brain, under the brain. That structure is called the circle of Willis, formed by arteries. This structure, circle of Willis, is very important because your brain gets blood from this circuit or circle of Willis. So we'll see the structure of this circle of Willis. Then we'll talk about the hepatic portal circulation. This hepatic portal circulation takes the blood from your intestine to the liver. That means nutrient-rich blood goes from the intestine to the liver. First, you already know that first we divide the circulation into two types: adult and fetal circulation. Adult circulation includes systemic, pulmonary, and hepatic portal. Those three, remember, belong to the adult circulation. And another is the fetal circulation, only occurs during the life when the fetus is inside the mother's uterus. Three types of blood vessels are present in the body: arteries, veins, and capillaries. As I have already mentioned, arteries take the blood away from the heart. That is the definition of an artery. Takes the blood away from the heart. It doesn't matter what kind of blood it takes. You know that in systemic circulation, arteries carry oxygenated blood, right? Takes the oxygenated blood out from the heart. In case of pulmonary circulation, arteries carry deoxygenated blood. So what type of blood is there, that is not the matter. The main thing is that arteries always take the blood away from the heart, and veins bring the blood towards the heart. In case of pulmonary circulation, you know that veins bring the oxygenated blood back into the heart, right? And arteries take the deoxygenated blood to the lung. So it's opposite than the systemic. Capillaries. Capillaries are the smallest blood vessels located between the arteries and veins. That means where the artery ends, the capillaries start, and then capillaries give the blood to the vein. It is like this. This is the artery, and smallest artery is called the arteriole. So this is the arteriole, and then it branches and form the capillary network. So this is the capillary network, and then from the other side of the capillary, small veins start. So the venous system starts here. Okay. So this is the arterial system, this is the capillary, and this is the venous system. Okay. So where the arteries end, capillaries start, and from the other side of the capillary, the veins or venous system start. And capillaries often form network that is called the capillary bed. Capillary bed. Okay. The network of capillaries. Now, the average diameter of a capillary is 8 micrometer. So very narrow, 8 micrometer. Capillary is very important. Why? Because the gas exchange of nutrients, all those exchanges take place through the capillary wall. Arteries only transport the blood. Veins only transport the blood. But exchange of the chemicals take place through the capillary wall. You know that tissue, these are the cells, right, from the tissue, needs oxygen, nutrients, hormones. Those enter into the tissue from the capillary. And we know that carbon dioxide from the tissue goes to the blood, metabolic waste from the tissue go to the blood. So the exchange of those chemicals take place to the capillary wall. That's why capillary is very important. Okay. Now, there are three types of arteries present in the body. Largest arteries are called the elastic or conducting arteries. Those are the largest arteries. For example, aorta. You know, aorta is the largest artery, right? The wall of the conducting or elastic arteries have lot of elasticity. That means the arteries can expand a lot, because you know that the tissue, elastic tissue, has the elasticity, right? So that's why these arteries are also called elastic arteries, because in the wall you have lot of elastic tissue, and these arteries can expand. Example, aorta and its large branches. Since the arteries, elastic arteries, can expand, the resistance in the wall is less or low. Just think that this is the artery, okay? Now, aorta, when your left ventricle contracts, right, blood enters into aorta. You know that, right? Ascending aorta. So, you know that left ventricle contracts forcefully, right? To send the blood throughout the body very strongly. So, when left ventricle contracts, the aorta, blood enters into the aorta and aorta expands to let the blood get in. Make sense? So, it expands. So, the large elastic arteries have the ability to expand. That means the pressure in the wall is low. Resistance is low. Muscular or distributing arteries are medium-sized arteries. They receive the blood from the elastic or conducting arteries and give the blood to different organs of the body. For example, this is aorta. So this is the elastic or conducting artery, large artery. Then we know that from the aorta, the branches arise, any branches arise. For example, your liver or stomach or kidney, those organs get the blood. So this is the kidney. Okay? So this is renal artery. This is the spleen, splenic artery. Gastric artery goes to the stomach. So those are the distributing or muscular arteries. So distributing or muscular arteries receive the blood from the elastic or conducting artery and give to different organs, okay, of the body. That's why they are called distributing. Now, why these arteries are also called muscular arteries? Because in the wall of these medium-sized arteries, you have more muscles than elastic tissue. In large arteries, you have more elastic tissue. That's why called elastic arteries. Then the smallest arteries are called the arterioles. So arterioles are the smallest arteries. And I have already mentioned that the capillary bed starts from the end of the arterial system. So from the end of the smallest artery, this is a small artery, arteriole, and the capillary bed starts here. So this is the arteriole. Here you see the wall of those three types of arteries and the tissues, amount of tissue, different types of tissue present in the wall. First, if you see the conducting or elastic artery wall, you will find more elastic tissue. That's why they are called elastic arteries. You see the right side's histograms. The blue bars are showing the elastic tissue and the red bars are showing the smooth muscle tissue. Now just focus on those two. Those two are important here. If you compare the blue, top, middle and lower, you see that elastic tissue is more in elastic arteries than the muscular and arterioles. Now let's see the red bars. You see the middle one is the tallest. That means in muscular artery, the muscle tissue, smooth muscle tissue, is more than the elastic and arteriole. That's why they are called the muscular artery. wall of the capillary. Capillary wall is very thin, which is important because you know that gas and nutrient or other chemicals, exchange of chemicals occur through the wall of the capillaries that I have mentioned. So the wall of the capillaries is very thin, so those chemicals can easily get out or get in. The capillary wall is formed by a simple squamous epithelial tissue. You know from NP1, simple squamous. Simple means one layer, and squamous is flat type cells, epithelial cells. So a simple squamous epithelial lining, and we always know that epithelial tissue rests on the basement membrane. So this is the wall of the capillary. So the chemicals can easily get out or get in. The wall of the venule. Venule is the smallest vein. So venules are the smallest veins. Arterioles are the smallest arteries, and venules are the smallest veins. Wall of the venule is also very thin. And also know that in the wall of the venule, you have simple squamous cells that forms the endothelium, and another type of cells, those are called pericytes. You see these red colored cells go around like this. Those are called the pericytes. And the blue cells, those are the simple squamous cells. Just for your information, in the wall of the venule, you have many pores or holes. Holes or pores in the wall of the venule. And you must remember from one of our previous lectures, I told you that if any infection or inflammation occurs in the body, then white blood cells by diapedesis get out to the pores, right? Remember that? And most of the cases, white blood cells get out through the pores in the venules, because venules have many pores. Vein. If you see here, is that you see the red colored layer, that's the muscular layer, smooth muscle layer in the vein. Now let's go back to the artery. You see, this is the wall of the artery. The amount of muscle tissue, smooth muscle tissue, or the layer of smooth muscle tissue is much thicker in the artery than in the vein. That is a difference between the artery and the vein. Another difference is, you see here again, since the muscle layer in the artery is thin, the lumen is narrow. Lumen is narrow. In case of the vein, since the wall is thin, the lumen is large. Large or thin. Okay. So, if I ask you, tell me the differences between an artery and a vein, but I'll say this is artery, this is vein, wall is thick, in vein the wall is thin. In artery, since the wall is thick, the lumen is small and narrow. Small or narrow,
same thing. Okay, in case of vein, the lumen is large. Inside the artery, the pressure of blood is high. Pressure is high. Inside the vein, the pressure is low. That makes sense, because when your heart pumps, first blood enters into the arteries, right? Because arteries take the blood away from the heart. So, from the heart, blood goes to the arteries. Now, after blood circulates through the arterial system, blood enters into what? The capillaries, right? Before it goes to the veins, it circulates in the capillary bed and then enters into the veins. So, the pressure is much higher in the artery because arteries get the blood directly from the heart, right? Then blood circulates in the capillaries, gets very slow, and from the capillaries enter into the vein. When the blood enters into the vein, it becomes very slow because vein is far away from the heart, right? So as the blood goes, gets slow, 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 and in the capillary bed gets really slow, and then enters into the veins. Another difference you already know, arteries take the blood away from the heart. Veins take the blood towards the heart. Towards the heart. Another thing is, if you cut the artery and see inside, the lumen always is open round. If you cut the vein, since the wall is thin, you'll see that the lumen is flat, kind of flat, and not wide open because the wall is thin there. Okay, so these are the differences between the arteries and veins. Just go over this slide. Here you see the arterial system, capillary bed, and the venous system that I showed you already. So from the heart, blood enters into the arteries, and from large elastic arteries go to the muscular or distributing arteries, and then the smallest arteries are the arterioles. Okay, most of the cases arterioles form capillaries and capillary bed. Here, sometimes we see that arterioles get connected to the venules without forming capillary beds. That is called arteriovenous anastomosis. So, without forming the capillary bed, arterioles give the blood to the venules directly. But most of the cases we see heart, capillary bed is formed from the end of the arterioles, and then from the capillary bed, venules get the blood. Now here you just see one important thing, that where the arterioles end and capillaries start, there are sphincters. These are the sphincters. Those are called pre-capillary sphincter. Pre means before, the capillary sphincters. And these sphincters control the amount of blood that enters into the capillary bed. If the sphincters are constricted, less blood will flow in the capillary bed. Make sense? Constricted. Less blood will enter into the capillary bed. When the sphincters are dilated, relaxed, more blood flows in the capillary bed. So you see, very important function, sphincters, three capillary sphincters regulate the amount of blood that enters into the capillary bed. Now you tell me a simple question. When you do exercise, this capillary, pre-capillary sphincters should get constricted or relaxed? Your tissue needs more oxygen, blood, or less? What do you think? When you do exercise, your tissue needs more blood or less blood? You know that, right? So the capillary sphincters should relax or not? Relax. Make sense? We have talked about the differences between systemic and pulmonary circulation, right? In last lecture, we talked about the heart. Now, we will try to identify the main arteries and veins. First, we'll see the arterial system of the body. Before we see the arteries and veins, just know one thing. You already know that arteries take the blood away from the heart, right? So, big arteries give blood to the smaller arteries. Make sense? So, from large arteries, blood goes to the smaller arteries. But in case of vein, it is opposite. Vein brings the blood towards the heart, right? Into the heart. So what happens? Small veins give blood to the larger veins, and then the largest veins drain the blood to the heart. Make sense? So in case of arterial system, large arteries give blood to the smaller arteries. In case of venous system, smaller veins give blood to the larger veins, or drain the blood to the larger veins. This is the arterial system of the body. Only large arteries are shown here. First, we'll talk about the systemic circulation. So, systemic circulation is the circulation of blood between the heart and the whole body, right? You know that. So, your body gets what kind of blood from the heart? Oxygenated or deoxygenated? Oxygenated, right? That is a simple question, like elementary school question. So, your body gets oxygenated blood from the heart, right? So, oxygenated blood is present in the left side or right side of the heart? Left side. So, and you already know that left ventricle pumps the blood out, right? So, when the left ventricle contracts, that is the start of the systemic circulation. Make sense? So, left ventricle contracts and blood enters into the aorta. Okay? So, this is the heart. This is the heart. Left ventricle, aorta. This. So, this is the ascending aorta, that receives the blood from the left ventricle. And then, next part of aorta is aortic arch, like St. Louis arch, right? And then the descending aorta. So, aorta has three parts, ascending, then aortic arch and descending. Make sense? Which part is the longest? What do you think?
So, ascending is short, then aortic arch, then descending is very long, okay? And descending aorta
is divided by the diaphragm. This is the diaphragm.
Okay? So, diaphragm is here, you know that, right? That separates the descending aorta into how many parts? Two parts, upper and lower.
Above the diaphragm, this part of descending aorta is called thoracic aorta. So, the part above the diaphragm is the thoracic aorta and the part below the diaphragm is abdominal aorta. Descending has two parts, thoracic and abdominal. And first, let's talk about the ascending aorta. Ascending aorta has two very important branches.
Those are called the right and left coronary arteries. You have already seen those.
So, coronary arteries, right and left.
These are the main branches of the ascending aorta.
Coronary arteries go to the wall of the heart. You know that, right? Wall of the heart. Then aortic arch. From the arch, how many arteries arise?
Three.
You already know that, right? Very good. So, one, two, three.
From the aortic arch.
If you go from the right to left, this is the brachiocephalic trunk. Brachiocephalic trunk. You must remember that.
Then left common carotid,
left subclavian.
These are the three arteries arise from the aortic arch. Make sense? Remember, right? Remember the heart model? See? Okay. So, you see here, you have left common carotid, left subclavian. Then there must be right common carotid, right subclavian, right? Since you have left common carotid, left subclavian, right common carotid and right subclavian, they don't directly arise from the aortic arch.
They are the branches of brachiocephalic trunk. So now you've got those two. This is right common carotid. This is right subclavian. Okay. So now you see here that you've got all four. Right common carotid, left common carotid, right subclavian, left subclavian.
So now it makes sense, right? You have two common carotids, right and left, two subclavians, right and left. Is it clear? Okay. So, now,
before we go to descending, just remember, we'll come back here. So, you need to remember these branches. We got right subclavian, right common carotid, left common carotid, left subclavian.
Now, subclavian. Subclavian means what? Sub means under. Clavian indicates clavicle. Make sense? So, you know this is the clavicle, right?
So subclavian runs under the clavicle and goes to the upper limb, goes to the arm. Is it clear? Subclavian under the clavicle and goes like that. So this is right, this is left subclavian. Common carotid. Remember, common carotid goes to the head. So straight up. So like this, you see, these are two common carotids going up towards the head, and these are subclavian going higher to the upper limbs. Is it clear? Okay, so we'll come back and I'll ask you, so don't forget that. Then let's talk about the descending aorta. Okay, so this is the thoracic part, this is the abdominal part. First let's talk about the thoracic aorta. Thoracic aorta gives several branches. Those are called intercostal arteries. These are intercostal arteries. Intercostal means what? In between the ribs, you know that. So, in between the ribs, intercostal spaces. So, intercostal arteries, you see, go like this in between the ribs. Make sense? Then, also from the thoracic aorta, branches go to the diaphragm. You know, this is the diaphragm. So, these are called superior sphenic arteries. So, these are superior phrenic arteries. Remember, the term phrenic indicates diaphragm. Phrenic nerve. When we say phrenic nerve, that means the nerve goes to diaphragm. Okay? Phrenic arteries, the arteries go to diaphragm. So, the word phrenic refers to diaphragm. So, superior phrenic arteries supply blood to the diaphragm from above. Now, let's see the abdominal aorta. From the front of the abdominal aorta, if this is the abdominal aorta, from the front, like this, some branches arise. Also from both sides, branches arise. First, we'll see which arteries arise from the front. Okay, so this is the celiac trunk, the topmost one from the front. Then superior mesenteric artery, inferior mesenteric artery. So those are three arteries arise from the front of the abdominal aorta: celiac trunk, superior mesenteric, inferior mesenteric. Now, the word, sometimes you see in arterial system, you hear instead of artery, you see the name is trunk. You remember pulmonary trunk? Right? Celiac trunk. What's the difference between a trunk and an artery? Trunk is an artery, but what kind of artery? Short, very short. If the artery is very short, that is a trunk. So, this is celiac trunk and this is a short artery, and from the celiac trunk, three arteries arise like this. One goes to the spleen, that is called the splenic artery. Another goes to the stomach, that's why it is called gastric makes sense, right? Those names are very simple.
Splenic artery goes to the spleen, gastric artery goes to what?
Stomach. We know gastric indicates stomach, right?
And
another artery, that is the hepatic, goes to what? What do you think? Liver.
Hepatic means liver, right? We say hepatic failure. So those are the three branches of that short ciliac trunk. It is very short, then divides into
stomach, that's gastric, one goes to the liver, that's the hepatic. Superior mesenteric. This one mainly or mostly supplies blood to the upper part of the intestine.
You know the intestine. Intestine has two parts. Small intestine and another is what? Large intestine, right? Have you heard that? So which one is the upper? Small or large? Small. So superior. Superior means upper, right? So superior mesenteric goes to the small intestine mainly, and inferior mesenteric goes where? The lower part, that's the large intestine. Is it clear? So superior mostly to the small intestine, inferior mesenteric mostly to the large intestine. There is some overlapping, but that's just, if you know that, should be good. Make sense?
Okay. Then from both sides, let's use a different color. From both sides of the abdominal aorta, a number of branches arise. What are those branches? Important branches are renal, goes to the kidney. You know, renal means kidney. So renal artery, right and left, because we know that we have two kidneys. Suprarenal. Suprarenal artery. Suprarenal artery goes to the suprarenal gland. Have you heard suprarenal gland? Also called what?
Suprarenal gland is also called the adrenal gland. Remember, on the kidney, adrenal glands. Okay, so suprarenal, supra means above, renal means kidney. On the top of the kidney, you have the adrenal glands.
So you have two suprarenal arteries, two renal arteries, gonadal arteries, and vertebral arteries. Not vertebral, that is called lumbar. Lumbar arteries. Okay. So those are the main arteries arise from the both sides of the abdominal aorta. Suprarenal goes to the adrenal gland or suprarenal gland. Renal goes to the kidney. Gonadal goes to the gonads, testes or ovaries, and lumbar goes to, this is the lumbar area of the body, you know that, the back of the abdomen, this is the lumbar area. So these muscles get blood from the lumbar arteries. Okay, so did you understand what I said? Not remember, but did you understand? Yes? Okay. So let me quickly review. So systemic circulation gives blood to the whole body, right? What kind of blood? Oxygenated blood. Oxygenated blood. I am not asking very difficult question, you know that. Okay. So from which chamber of the heart your aorta receives oxygenated blood? Left ventricle. Make sense? When left ventricle contracts, blood enters into the aorta, right? Now aorta has three parts. First part is going up, that ascending, then it turns like arch, aortic arch. then descending. Which part is the longest? Descending. So descending passes through the diaphragm, right? So above the diaphragm, that part is the thoracic, and below abdomen. So not different, right? Now, from ascending aorta, two arteries arise. Very important artery of the body. They go to the wall of the heart. Those are called what? Coronary arteries, right? Right and left. Make sense? Now, aortic arch. From arch, how many arteries arise? Three. From right to left, brachiocephalic trunk, then left what? Common carotid, left subclavian. So, where are right common carotid and right subclavian? From the trunk, right? Brachiocephalic trunk. So, make sense? Now you got what? Right common carotid, right subclavian, left common carotid, left subclavian. Make sense? So it's like this. So subclavian, that means it runs under the clavicle. Under the clavicle means going towards the arm. Is it clear? Upper limb. And common carotids are going upwards. That means towards the head. Is it clear? Make sense? Okay. Now, the thoracic aorta, the upper part of descending, right? From thoracic aorta, a number of branches arise and they go to the spaces between the ribs, intercostal arteries. Make sense? And two arteries arise and go to the diaphragm from above. That means what? Superior phrenic. Remember, phrenic means diaphragm, okay? Superior phrenic arteries. Okay. Then, those are the main branches. Then, the abdominal aorta, right? That's the part supplies blood to the abdomen. And you have several organs in the abdomen, right? Your stomach, spleen, liver, kidneys, right? Adrenal glands, those should get blood. Make sense? Okay. So, from the front of the abdominal aorta, three arteries arise. The most upper one is the ciliar trunk. Make sense? It gives how many branches? Three. One goes to the spleen, right? Splenic. One goes to the stomach, gastric. One goes to the liver, hepatic. Make sense? Okay. Superior mesenteric. Remember, mesenteric goes to the intestine. So, superior mesenteric goes to the upper part of the intestine. That is small or large? Oh. Small. Inferior mesenteric goes to the large intestine. There is overlap, like part of, you know, superior goes to large, part of inferior goes to small, but just know the basic things. From both sides, you have paired arteries. These are unpaired, right? Because only one ciliar trunk, one superior mesenteric, one inferior mesenteric. Make sense? But from both sides, you have what? Paired arteries. Like two suprarenal, two renal, because you have two kidneys, two adrenal glands. Make sense? Two gonads, two lumbar. Clear? Okay. Another one you also need to know. From the abdominal aorta, also branches go to the diaphragm. So if this is superior mesenteric, this one is what? Sorry, this is superior phrenic, this must be inferior phrenic, because going from below, right? So these are inferior phrenic arteries. These are superior phrenic arteries. Both go to the diaphragm. Okay, so that's the abdominal aorta. Now, let's see what happens to the subclavian and common carotid arteries. You already know. This is the right subclavian. Right subclavian goes to the right arm and this is the right common carotid goes to the head. Left common carotid also goes to the head and this is left subclavian goes to the arm, left side. So what happens when the subclavian enters into the armpit area, like subclavian then enters into the armpit, that is called axillary. Makes sense because we know that this is armpit is called the axillary area, right? So axillary artery, and then enters into the arm, that is the brachial artery. We know that brachial artery is here, right? This is the brachial part, axillary part. You all know that. So brachial artery. Then it goes to the forearm. Before it enters into the forearm, it divides into two, like this. The lateral one is the radial, because we know that the radius is the bone here, so radial artery, and medial bone is what? Ulnar. So this is the ulnar artery. So in the forearm you have radial and ulnar, and then what happens, you see, the radial and ulnar come to the palm and they join, they branch and join like this, form arches. So form two arches like this, these are the arches in the palm. One is the superficial, another is the deep palmar arches. Here, two arms, the arches are formed. And from there, the branches go to the fingers. Those are called the digital arteries. So these are the arches, palmar arches and digital arteries. So that's the upper limb. Okay, the main arteries in the upper limb. So let's see here. You see the subclavian. This is the subclavian. This is clavicle, the bone, right? So this is the subclavian. Axillary, you see the axillary artery, right? Then brachial, this one, then divides into radial and ulnar, and here in the palm you see two arches, superficial palmar arch and deep palmar arch, and then the digital arteries. Those are the main arteries. Now this is subclavian, subclavian artery, and from subclavian, three arteries arise. From subclavian, these are the three arteries arise. So you need to know those three. Okay, so let's see what are those three. Those are two trunks and one artery from subclavian. Had a cervical trunk, goes to cervical trunk and vertebral artery. This is one side. Same thing happens in the other side. From subclavian, in this side also, three arteries arise. Two trunks and one vertebral artery. Okay, Now, before we go to the lower limb, one more thing we need to know. What is that? You already know that two common carotids, these two, right, go to the what? Head, right? Remember? When you will hear the term common in arterial system, remember, common divides into two. Common divides into two, external and internal. Just keep that in your mind. So common divides into what? Two, external and internal. So now, since these are common carotid, this is right common carotid, this is left common carotid, right? Both will divide what? Into two, external and internal. So this will divide into two, external and internal. This will also divide into two, external and internal. Okay? So, right internal, left internal, right external, left external carotids. Is it clear? Okay. Now, very simple question. You got two, two. Four, right, are going to the head. Two externals and two internals. So, which ones will go to the external part of the head? External or internal? External. Make sense? So, external part of the head means what? Your brain or other structures around the brain? Other structures. So, two externals will supply to the head, but outer part of the head. Make sense? Your skin, muscles, skull, make sense? Bones, those structures will get blood from the external carotid. Now, internal. Internal will go to the which part of the head? Inner? In, right? That means what? Which structure is there? Very important. The brain. Make sense? So, your brain mostly receives blood from the internal carotids. Remember that. So that is one source how the brain gets blood. Another source is the vertebral artery. You remember from subclavian three arteries arise: hyrocervical, costocervical, and vertebral. This one, two vertebral, one from left subclavian, another from right subclavian. Vertebral also go to the brain. Remember. So, internal carotid, two internal carotids and two vertebral arteries. These are the main arteries supply blood to the brain.
Okay? Need to know that. Okay, now we'll see the lower limbs. So what happens? The lower end of the abdominal aorta divides into two. The lower end of abdominal aorta divides into two. Left common ilia artery, and this is the right common iliac artery. So, right and left common iliacs. I told you in arterial system, common will divide into what? Two. Which two? External and internal. So, both will divide into two. External and internal. Internal, external. So this is external iliac, this is internal iliac. This is internal, this is external. Common will divide into
external and internal. Okay. So, here you look at me from the lower end of abdominal aorta. The first it divides into two, common iliac, right and left. The common iliacs divide into two, internal and external. External iliacs go to the thigh and internal goes to the pelvic area here. So these two supply blood to the pelvic organs here and external go to the lower limbs. Externals are much bigger than internal iliacs. Internal are smaller and stays there and supply blood to the pelvic area. Is it clear? External are much bigger and go to the leg, thigh. Okay. Now, you see it is very simple. When the external iliac enters into the thigh, this area is called what? Femoral area, right? We know that femur is the bone here. So, the artery's name becomes what? Femoral artery. Make sense? Which area is the back of the knee? Popliteal. Remember that? So, when it goes to the back of the knee, its name is popliteal artery. Make sense? Then, popliteal artery, you see here, this is the common iliac. This tiny one is the internal iliac and this big one, larger one is the external iliac that goes to the thigh and becomes the femoral artery. And then to the back of the knee, popliteal artery. And then popliteal artery divides into anterior and posterior tibial. So, the main bone of the leg is the tibia. So, the popliteal divides and the branch that goes to the front of the tibia, that is the anterior tibial and the one here, you see, anterior tibial, popliteal, then anterior tibial and posterior tibial. From the upper part of posterior tibial, fibular artery arises. So this is very simple. In your leg, you have how many bones? In this part, tibia and fibula. So you have tibial artery, fibular artery. How many tibial arteries? Two, anterior and posterior. One is going in the to the front of the tibia, anterior tibial, one in the back, posterior tibial. And one going to the lateral side, which is the fibula bone. So that's the fibula. In your forearm, you have two bones, right? Laterally radius, medially ulna. So you have radial artery, ulnar artery. So just if you think, a lot of things make sense and it will be easy for you. Then, the posterior tibial divides into lateral and medial plantar. We all know that the sole of the foot is called the plantar surface and this is the dorsal surface. Sole is what? Plantar. So goes to the sole of the foot and divides into two plantar, medial and lateral. And two plantars join to form an arch that is called the plantar arch. Those are towards the sole of the foot. Anterior tibial. Anterior tibial artery runs to the goes to the front of the tibia and it becomes dorsalis pedis artery. So this is anterior tibial and when it goes to the front of the ankle, this is I may ask you, anterior tibial goes down and when it enters the front of the ankle, that artery is now called dorsalis pedis artery. and then this one forms an arch that is called the arcuate artery. Here you see dorsal pedis, front of the ankle, and arcuate artery. And from arcuate artery, these branches are metatarsal, because we know these bones are metatarsals here. So metatarsal arteries arise from arcuate. So that's the lower limbs. So let's stop here today. It's not difficult. Initially you may think it's too many things, but if you just study systematically, it will make sense. Make sense?